everybody, and welcome to Vintage House. My name is Katie. I am the program manager here at Vintage House, and I would just like to thank all of you for braving the heat and coming out today to be here for this wonderful talk. And for those of you joining us on Zoom, I hope you're staying cool in the comfort of your home. So this has been a real joy to bring this four-part series to you in collaboration with the Sonoma Valley Hospital. We have been doing this since 2014, and we did have a little hiccup during COVID, and you're going to hear a little bit more about COVID in a minute from a really positive, empowering point of view. But I will leave that introduction to Dawn Kuwahara, who's standing right next to me. She's our master of ceremonies. Thank you for being here, Dawn. Dawn is the chief officer of outpatient services at Sonoma Valley Hospital, and she is going to be introducing our guest speaker today and also on the other Wednesdays. I would also like to mention before I hand you over to Dawn that be sure to check out the two tables back there. The Sonoma Valley Hospital has a few flyers and goodies on the table. And the Vintage House, we have a table with some information about programs. And if you get thirsty or would like some coffee, right back there, we have a table with some beverages. So without further ado, here is Dawn. Thank you so much, Dawn.
Hello, everyone. It's my pleasure to be here today and welcome you to the 8th year of our Active Aging series. We began this legacy series in 2014 because we wanted to bring experts to the Valley to talk about valuable information in health. So I have been participating for many years and have always been amazed by the welcoming of the Vintage House and our subject matter experts. So before I introduce Dr. Flett, a few reminders. For those of you who are attending in person, we have question cards on your chairs. And at the end of our presentation, we'll ask you to pass your questions down to the end, and Dr. Flett will answer your questions. We also ask that you mute your cell phones. And for those of our audience who are watching the presentation remotely, don't forget to turn off your mics. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Sonoma Valley Hospital and Vintage House for sponsoring this event. We really appreciate it. And to Celia in the back from Sonoma Valley Hospital and Katie from Vintage House, they've worked really hard to put this event together. We also have a member of the Sonoma Valley Hospital board. Ms. Idell, can you raise your hand? Thank you for joining us. So now I would like to introduce my esteemed colleague and subject matter expert, Dr. Mary Flett. Just a little intro about Dr. Flett. She is a keen observer of what it means to be an aging adult. We are ecstatic that she opens the 2022 Active Aging Lecture Series. An author, speaker, content creator, and founder of the Five Pillars of Aging. Dr. Mary Flett is based here in the Valley of the Moon, and she is an expert in aging with finesse and shares her experience for 30 years as a clinical psychologist. She writes a weekly blog and has published a collection of them in her three-book series, Aging with Finesse. I like that. Dr. Mary is an activist in challenging the rampant ageism that exists and invites all of us to age better and to age well. She brings her unique perspective on embracing the shift that aging brings. Dr. Mary is a passionate and engaging speaker on all things related to aging and is known for her unique ability to bring humor and compassion to complex and emotionally challenging topics. So I have to add to that, I've had the pleasure of working with Dr. Mary for many years, and I am inspired by her knowledge and her compassion, but I think more importantly, she has the best sense of humor. So please join me in giving a big hand for Dr. Mary Flett. Thank you.
Thank you, Dawn. I have to admit, I wrote that introduction, so I have to live up to it now. As this week was progressing, I kept thinking, as I was in my new weight loss program due to melting, that we may not be able to go forward with this, which of course has actually underscored what's been happening for the last few years with COVID, right? You wake up in the morning and have to figure out whether or not you can go outside, what you're limited and can do, and what you can and can't do. One of the joys of being here in front of you live, as well as with our streaming audience, is that we're back in contact with one another. And I don't know about you all, but I find it exhausting. I'm going to talk a little bit about that today and just some of the insights that I've learned. It's been said already, but I want to give a shout out again to Celia Cruz de la Rosa, who's the extraordinary marketing director and community outreach director of Sonoma Valley Hospital. She puts the heart in the hospital and connects us as members of the community, whether we're in the ER or needing services or not. She's wonderful. Dawn Kuaharwa, well, your check's in the mail, Dawn, so don't worry. Extraordinary leader, and that's what we have found in this valley, is we have a deep bench of leadership to get us through these difficult times. And that includes Katie, who is back up at the front of working the front desk here at Vintage House, Katie DeYoung, who has gone from a essentially just kind-hearted person who was volunteering her time here a number of years ago to being program director here, and has done enormous amounts of creative, active work in bringing new and differing programs to meet the needs of aging adults in the valley. And as Dawn said, here we are. This is 2014, my dear friend and colleague, Louise Aronson, kicked off the speaker. I love dropping her name. If you don't know about Louise Aronson, she's a gerontologist, she's with UCSF. She wrote the Pulitzer Prize nominated, boy, I get to say that about somebody I know. Pulitzer Prize nominated book called Elderhood. One of the things about my work now that I'm retired is that I've changed the focus and dropped all the paperwork. So I'm incredibly happy because of that. But I haven't changed my passion. So let's start to go through this. I will try and be ambidextrous with tech. Okay, that's not working. Let's try this. Hey, I may have to stay a bit closer here, so forgive me. Why am I standing up in front of you? Well, you know, I could really drop all of the fascinating pieces of information about my background. Well, I might as well, because I can brag. So 30 years as a psychologist, I always had my practice working with aging adults. And it was perfectly selfish that I did that, because I wanted to know how to grow old well. And I took advantage of the people who came in to see me, even though they were maybe challenged by some issues in their life. I watched how people solved those problems. And it was my pleasure and it was my privilege to be participant in that activity, but I think I got more out of it than they did. So I'm up here because of them. And I just turned 69. Now, I don't know about you, but I still have pictures in my head of my grandmother at 64. She didn't make it to 69, and she looked 170. I mean, the pin curls and the dress, and I don't feel 69. Of course, I'm not quite sure what 69 is supposed to feel like. And that's the challenge of every one of us sitting in this room today, is we are treading unknown territory. No group this large has lived this long, this well. Think about that for a second. The average age length nowadays in our time frame has gone from 64 to 85. And what screwed it up was COVID. Pay no attention to that woman coughing in the front. We have many medical professionals here who can manage that. I can't not work. How many of you are just out of work as opposed to retired? Do you understand what I'm saying here? Most of us, after our jobs, our doing period, went into a transition of being or becoming. I became an entrepreneur, and I am still doing things. So I'm a human doing that's working towards becoming a human being. And I think that really is the invitation, that if we pay attention to living better and living well, if we accept that, to change from a human doing to a human being, it opens up a whole range of possibilities for how we can age better and age well. So five pillars of aging is my excuse for getting out in the morning and talking to people and chatting. I also got to be the kickoff speaker for this series. And what's so fun about that is I get to lead the way for everybody else, and they now have to achieve this bar or better, and you will compare all of them to me. That's the advantage of going first. Katie already went over these, but I'm going to do it again because there's nothing worse than having somebody's cell phone go off. So please do check to see that your cell phone is not, because I will just be quiet until you take that call. Okay. That's how fun that is. Of course, that happened to me once, and I was giving that look out, whose phone is that? Nobody, it was mine. So mine's on mute now. I made sure of that. I think what I'm going to do today is wait for questions until the end, if that's okay with you, so that we can also make sure that we have questions from the folks in the streaming audience, which you can just put into your chat, and we have somebody monitoring the chat back there. For those of you that are here, if you have legible writing, write it on the card. Otherwise, we'll have to be running around with one of these microphones for people to hear, and that's a real pain in the tuchus, so I don't think we want to do that exercise, so write them down. We're going to have an activity, because this is about health and wellness. And I'm holding this noodle. I will not be hitting you with this if you give me the wrong answer. This is actually an optional activity that'll be a whole group activity that I'm hoping is going to be fun. That's my plan anyway, so that'll be the mystery. And bathrooms, if for those of you that are here in Vintage House or down the hall and on the right, I always feel like I'm doing the flight attendant. You know, in case of an emergency, the oxygen will drop down in front of you and put your mask on first. My COVID story. Once upon a time, I spent about 8 years with two disgustingly deteriorating hips to the point that I was virtually unable to walk more than 10 or 15 feet without some form of assistance. And I had the good fortune of being referred to, I'm going to put a plug in for a different hospital, sorry about this, Adventist Health over in Napa, and had both of my hips replaced within 9 weeks of each other so that I could go on my bucket list trip to New Zealand. Now, I have a friend who's a travel agent. This is the best way to do these things. And I said to her, I'm quitting. I'm going to take 30 days off. I want a nice trip to decompress and change from going from being a psychologist to just being a retired person. And she said, I've got it. You spend a week in Hawaii, you fly down to Sydney, you spend 2 or 3 days down there, you get on a cruise, you go to New Zealand, you come back, you spend another week in Hawaii, Aloha. So I dutifully, with my new hips, got on, went to Honolulu, and I'm walking on Waikiki Beach thinking, oh my God, I'm fat and white, but I'm walking. And I had just the most relaxing, marvelous time in the islands. Got on board the flight to Sydney, arrived in Sydney, different day, different language, different weather, and I had this extraordinary B&B in a small part of New Zealand, of Sydney, where I walked around the neighborhood, and it just was one of these marvelous exploration trips. So I'm all set, I'm going, I'm ready now. Spent the week in Sydney. Oh my God, I got to go to the Sydney Opera House. I don't know how many of you are opera fans, but this is a picture that I actually took from the back of the ship as it was leaving Sydney Harbor on my way to New Zealand. And it was the night after the last night of the Sydney Opera House. Just had a blast. So I'm on this ship. I don't know, how many of you have been to New Zealand or Australia? Okay, you know, there's a big bunch of water in between Sydney and New Zealand. It's like not even spitting distance. It's like a day and a half cruising, just really rowing really hard. So we're on the ship going over there, and we keep hearing these rumors that there's this thing called COVID, and people were getting sick, and we might have to shut the trip down soon, or we might not, or maybe we could, but we're on the cruise, who cares? We're just gonna party. So off we go, and as soon as we got to New Zealand, the captain came on and said, we're turning around and going back. Because at that point, Australia was shutting down its ports. And we literally, it took us a day and a half to get there in the original thing, we made it back in 8 hours. Talk about rowing. Unfortunately, we hadn't had much time to visit New Zealand. So I missed out on this bucket trip. Got into port at like 2 a.m. They offloaded us at 7 a.m. Literally went from the ship to the airport, landed an SFO, got on the airporter, arrived here. I hadn't seen another human being since I got off that ship. SFO was empty. The airporter was empty. And I thought, what happened to everybody? So I'm sitting at home, and the phone rings. And this lovely voice on the other end says, oi, matey, I'm calling you from New Zealand Public Health, and I want to tell you, you've been exposed to COVID. Well, you know, when I thought back on it, I was a little tired. I was coughing, but I figured that was, you know, just allergies. I was sneezing, I knew that was allergies. And I didn't really feel great, but I was okay until I lost my sense of taste and smell. Then it occurred to me that something had happened. So, following the instructions from the New Zealand Public Health, I called my primary care physician and said, I need a COVID test. And I was told to go to the county. Remember, this is in March of 2020, okay? Oh, the county has it, you did it. Well, I'm making all these phone. I'm a healthcare professional, and I couldn't get a COVID test. So I ended up, a few days later, going to see my primary care physician, who was in a hazmat suit. 20 feet of that nose thing, it was like a javelin, because she wanted to stay so far away from me. You know, I had to wait 5 days. You know, nobody waits 5 days for a COVID test result anymore. But in 2020, 5 days, and it was positive. Now, with what we know now, I probably had done damage from the moment I got off the ship. until I arrived in town. Fortunately, I hadn't seen anybody. And by the time I got tested, I probably wasn't transmitting to anybody anymore. But we didn't know that then. And I just want to take a moment to remind you what we didn't know then. Golly, we were naive. Golly, we were naive. So with my mild symptoms, feeling fine, I really didn't pay much attention to anything. You know, I just went about my life. Except, of course, for the weight gain. Would you believe it? I used to be 5'8" and 110. I didn't think you'd believe it. The freshman 20, I'm an overachiever. Okay. I put a lot of weight on because I wasn't doing anything. Unfortunately, I also have long COVID. And the symptoms vary. I'm part of the UCSF study because on the surface, I'm just an older adult who complains too much. And again, I want you to put a bookmark there because this has been one of the challenges of understanding not just COVID and COVID symptoms, but understanding the healthcare needs of aging adults. Okay? Brain fog. There is nothing, you are lucky so far because I have not gone for that gasp, that chasm, pause, where I can't remember the word, which is all too frequent with this. I got plenty of sleep last night, so the fatigue's not too bad, but just 3 days ago, I had to take a 4-hour nap after having done absolutely nothing. This fatigue hits me like a sack. And there's no predicting. There's no way of triggering it. The shortness of breath is compounded by the weight gain and the lack of exercise, but there's something else going on there. So I'm a doctor's joy. The other thing, as a psychologist, is that I now have a great deal more empathy for many of my patients because I've had some pretty severe depressive episodes. And I don't want to scare you. Most people think sadness is depression. Depressive episodes are the ones where you can't get out of bed, you don't eat anything, you don't take a bath for days, and all the thoughts in your head are about dying. Creative ways to kill yourself. Now that usually scares the pants off of most people. As a practicing psychologist, it was like, come on down, I've got some work to do here. But this was me. Now fortunately, I actually have skills. I actually have strategies to manage this. And because of that, I've been able to make my way through this. But I am going to bring this lesson home to you at the very end of this. Reach out and get support. It is essential that we do that. I also have experienced deep levels of isolation. Now that word is very precise, not loneliness, isolation. Isolation was enforced because of the need for quarantine, right? And many people experience that as deeply disturbing. There are others of us who actually found it to be a relief. And we're going to talk about some of the insights that came from that. So lessons, what have we learned? We are so vulnerable. COVID is going to be with us for the rest of time. There is no cure for this virus. It is stronger than we are, more inventive than we are, and will continue to replicate itself long after we're gone. It doesn't mean we're helpless. It just means we're vulnerable. And if you can wrap your mind around vulnerability versus helplessness and embrace being vulnerable, you'll find that there are ways to manage it that are much more successful than trying to manage helplessness. I cannot emphasize how important it is to remain connected. Some of the greatest suffering was not physiologic suffering. It was spiritual and psychological suffering. People who were not able to be with their loved ones in the last moments of life. People who had different versions and different stages of dementia, for whom reality made no sense, and we were unable to provide a context for them to manage their distress. Staying connected as a professional, when we were asked to go above and beyond what we were normally asked to do, if I hadn't had my colleagues and I hadn't had online support groups, I wouldn't have made it through. And I suspect that each of you found ways to connect with people and then found those people with whom connection was positive, and maybe were surprised by some people with whom connection was not. So this became a really interesting exploration of how we need to stay engaged. What I learned about myself was I had some really deeply entrenched habits, what I thought were healthy things, but when I couldn't do them anymore, I had to come up with alternatives really quickly. And some of those alternatives were pretty good, and others were, oh my God, let's try this, we're flying by the seat of our pants. Okay, one day we'd try one thing, the next day we'd hear somebody tell us it had to be done this way, the third day after that, that was confusing. And then, I don't know about you, but I was walking around going, I can't trust anybody, I don't know what they're talking about. And you know what really made me mad? Is I thought I was prepared. You know, I had to face this. And I think that was the hardest thing. So in spite of all of my training, in spite of everything I knew, in spite of 60-some-odd years of life experience, I couldn't figure it out. Temporarily. And that was one of the saving graces of all of this. Because we do need to rely on each other. And there were people that came through. And in surprising ways. I mean, just think back the last 2 years. Who showed up for you? And who did you show up for? You know, I had a neighbor. Do you remember the days when we were washing down our groceries? So I had a neighbor who, because of my long COVID stuff, came and did my shopping for me and put the groceries outside and then was really concerned because she was afraid that she would be bringing in some horrible, terrible thing on top of what was going on. She really showed up for me. I haven't seen her in months now because she has a life. And I'm no longer washing my groceries down. I was able to show up for people that around, literally on the other side of the world, because of streaming. I was able to connect with people in other parts of the world who were feeling disconnected and providing services to them online. Shared resources. The things that I expected to be there, and then when they weren't, we had to figure it out. You know, again, pointing out COVID tests. Now you just go online to USPS.gov and they'll send you COVID tests for your home. I had a friend visiting a couple weeks ago. She said, can I take a couple of these home with me? I said, are you sick? Those are my tests. You can't have my tests. Golly, we're resilient. We're still here. And 6.5 million people aren't. That's the ravage of COVID. 650 million people have been diagnosed since we started this thing. I happen to be the second person in Sonoma Valley who was diagnosed. Worldwide, 650,000. Those are only the ones that are reported, because there are many people who never were diagnosed. And there may be a number of you who are under the mistaken, this is my personal opinion, and you can disagree with me if you want, mistaken idea that you didn't get it. COVID is everywhere. You may not have had bad symptoms, but COVID is everywhere. What do I know? What do I know? I really pondered this. This was one of these aha moments. We all shared this experience, but we all experienced it differently. Think about that. There's this sort of theoretical thing called COVID, pandemic. And then there's the moment you take when somebody coughs. And you go, or you walk into a place like we did today and are wearing masks. Oh, we don't need to wear masks now. Only wusses wear masks. Or you're shocked and find out that somebody has COVID and they've had all their boosters. Wasn't that the contract? If I get all my shots and do things right, I won't get it? So we all experienced it differently, even though it was a shared experience. Extroverts had a much harder time with the pandemic than introverts did. Do you all know extroverts versus introverts? You know, even the fact that I have to ask that question anymore seems kind of silly, because everybody knows about extroverts and introverts, right? People who struggled with this were the people who could not be in contact. We saw this particularly with children who absolutely needed their socialization and to be together and benefited from that. And then there were people like me who I just, oh my God, I don't have to talk to anybody today. Heaven. And now at the other side of this, as we're coming back, as we're emerging, which is what the whole point of this conversation is today, learning those habits all over again. I was sharing with one of my friends who's here today that I actually get tired talking to people. You know, because I'm out of shape. I'm out of shape. But I'm realizing how much I missed it. One of the most deeply hit groups were family caregivers. And they were having a rough time to begin with. Any of you here who know someone who is caring for someone with a form of dementia, whether it's Alzheimer's or frontal temporal lobe dementia, or even just an aging parent who needs more and more care, realizes the amount, not just of time and energy that's involved, but the emotional debt that and toll that that takes. Having to organize things around care for people was challenging because of lack of caregivers. There's just not enough out there. But with COVID, oy, crazy. And we haven't done enough to reach out and find ways to support caregivers in this. Here's another aha that I had. Health is not the absence of disease. And up until COVID, that's kind of how I thought what healthy was. You know, no aches, no pains, your blood and pressure is under control, your A1C is within good reason, you exercise, you go to church, you have friends, you walk the dog, you know, all of those things. That was the absence of disease. But now I realize health is so much more. Health is community. Health is freedom of choice and access. Health is counted by how many friends I have, as well as how easily I can call my primary care physician and get a referral. health is absence of fear. And we need to take responsibility for our health. I think this was one of the first things that I realized, sort of the deer in the headlights moment when COVID first started. It was like, well, but this isn't supposed to happen. And it kept happening and kept happening and kept happening and kept happening. You know, poor Dr. Fauci. Honestly, the man, it seemed like every week he had to come up and just say, you know, we're learning. We don't know.
But you're supposed to know because you're a doctor.
Well, we're vulnerable. We don't know. But we're learning. And we've learned so much. It is important to exercise. It is important to eat right. It is important to know and understand how your body works, which is what this series of four lectures is all about, helping you to learn more. You are already acting affirmatively about your own health by being here and continuing to learn and taking responsibility for things. Before and after, okay, it's BC. You know, BC and AD. BC, remember when we used to do this? You know, these are like, everybody got together for selfies, and oh yeah, we're okay, they're all scrunched together, we never think twice about it. And after COVID, it is social distancing. This may not be true for you, but I still have this in my brain. I will go into doctor judgment if somebody is too close to me in line. Or if I'm at checkout, especially at Whole Foods, this really pisses me off. Be careful if you see me at Whole Foods. If you crowd the checkout counter and I haven't put all my stuff out yet, I'm gonna be 6 feet, 6 feet. But we also lost this. This was before COVID. Before COVID, we believed there was a future. We knew there was a future. Not now. It's not guaranteed. The gift of this, and I do look at it as a gift, is that it reminded me that we really only have the present. Some a day is not guaranteed. We lost the belief that the world is a safe place. It became very real very quickly that it is not. And this is one of the most difficult barriers to emerging from COVID. It's that doubt, that mistrust. We see it rampant in the news. How many of you have become experts in monoclonal antibodies? How many of you are viral epidemiologists now and can carry on conversations? Well, darn near everybody in here, because that's all we've been fed for 2 years. Now, for those people who actually have degrees in this area, they're all going, oh my God. And the rest of us are walking around like, I know what I'm talking about. That virus ain't gonna get me. So let's talk about some strategies here. What can we do to get to my slide so I know what I'm going to talk about here? What are the strategies? These happen to be tied into my five pillars of aging. So my first pillar is creating a legacy of values. And the strategy for rebuilding trust and emerging has to do not with arguing science. I mean, that's useful, and certainly bench science needs to continue. But coming together around shared values, not right and wrong, but shared values. For example, compassion. It's really hard to argue against compassion when we're all in the same boat. Decency, kindness. Those are values I think we can have a conversation around, particularly as they relate to moving forward in a world that isn't as safe as it once was, doesn't quite meet our needs the way it did before. But then also values like justice and freedom and respect, and perhaps most importantly, community. We are so lucky, those of you that are streaming, I hope if you're local, if you're outside of the Sonoma Valley area, I hope you can somehow tap into the Valley of the Moon spirit here, because we have a community that cares. And I have such respect for how this community comes together to help one another. Can we improve it? Absolutely. Are there more things that we need to do? You betcha. But, oh my gosh, we know community, and we know how important community is to moving forward. So when you create a legacy of values, particularly as an elder, someone who has a few years of experience under your belt, I believe it's imperative to leave that as a legacy. What have you learned about your life? And if you don't have children or grandchildren, there are many solo agers these days, you leave that legacy in places like this. We're in Stone Hall. That's a legacy. It's a legacy that took the form of a building, but it's a legacy that came from the heart and the collaboration of people in this valley to want to make sure that there is a place where elders can gather, leaving a legacy of values. And they're going to be different for everybody, but there's a chance, much greater chance, to come together around a conversation of values. Any of you have tried to raise money, you know this, than to ask people for money, right? Come, let's talk about our values and give me $5 on the side and then we'll talk. Staying engaged, okay? Physically, emotionally, spiritually, socially. Engagement is what it's all about. Okay? Engagement requires curiosity. It requires a level of openness to experience because things are different and new. It requires that we challenge strongly held beliefs and just contemplate the possibility that there might be another way of looking at things. If we hadn't done that and we hadn't stayed engaged and hadn't stayed focused on how to manage this pandemic, we wouldn't be sitting here. The number of different kinds of masks in this room is just one indicator. Do you remember the iteration of masks? Okay, and how many businesses sprung up around masks? You know? I mean, it just is amazing how staying engaged instead of succumbing to being frozen with fear. And now, fear is an experience. It is temporary. I'm going to say that again. Fear is temporary and needs to be supplanted by action. Staying engaged will get you there. If you are having difficulty moving, maybe you just play around with noodles. If we have some time, we might actually do some engagement here to see how that works. But I've been talking a lot, so I may not be able to do that. Mind, body, and spirit. So engagement in all realms here. I'm turning things and not clicking on the clickers. Okay. There we go. Where we age is kind of important. I do not know anybody who has it in their estate plan to die in a nursing home. No? I'm shocked, okay. Interesting statistic, Stanford Institute on Longevity did this poll, and they found that 80% of people who they polled said they wanted to die in their own beds at home. Only 40% got to do that. So where are we living before we die? Okay. We live in a I don't know about you, but climate change. Who knew? COVID and climate change, aren't we lucky? Living and staying in our own homes may be ideal, but that will require that the healthcare delivery systems be completely changed. Those of you who are currently living in assisted living like Cogir or have plans to move into some form of assisted living, get your name on the list now, because guess what? We're not dying. So those rooms aren't going to open up. Here's another something to think about. When was the last time, other than your partner, spouse, or chosen cohabitator, did you live with other people? Okay. I was in college, and they were all idiots. For some of others of you, it might have been when you were in the military. I bring this up because we're not used to living in congregate settings. That's the fancy word for it, congregate settings. When we move in close to one another, all those things that irritate you about your partner, spouse, friend are multiplied. Except for you. You're fine. You know, just everybody else. But the challenge, the true challenge of what I call elder ghettos is that they're not building new ones. There's not going to be enough for all of us. So where are we going to live? How are we going to maintain the levels of engagement, independence, community, if we don't have a roof over our head? Which brings me to the next level, which is spiritual awakening. And this can run the gamut from organized religion to people who are atheists, but who are contemplating what the purpose and meaning of their lives are at this point. So I talked to you about human doing and human being, and I'm working on the human being part. I have found something that gives my life purpose and meaning. I get to share my experience with other people and make you laugh a little bit about it, but hopefully make you think and consider things in a different way that might improve how you make decisions about your remaining years. What purpose and meaning do you have in your life? And again, there's no judgment on it. There's all kinds of things. Without purpose and meaning, we wither. We wither. And there's too much joy and information and history and experience in this room to waste it. So I invite you to think about these last decades of your life, not just months, days, weeks. Maybe for some of you it is months, days, weeks. But for the others of you, where it is decades, how are you going to plot that out? What will give you purpose and meaning as you continue to age? And the last of my five pillars is what I call emotional economics. Okay, now, mind you, I don't know squat about money. I do know a lot about self-worth. And what I have found is there are four things that as we age, we become confronted with. The question and how we answer this is, am I enough? This seems to be particularly challenging for many women, especially older women. But I think all of us who are no longer performing a duty or having a job, as soon as we lose that status, we have to kind of prove our worth. So, are you enough? Do you believe you are enough? And what would it take for you to challenge beliefs that say you aren't enough? I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not pretty enough. I'm not thin enough. I mean, all of those things that are out there. For me, and this is where my anti-ageist piece comes in. It's like, I am really sick and tired of being told I'm not old enough. You know, so think about it though, right? The words we use to describe ourselves now. I have twice in my lifetime graduated. That was the last two times I was a senior. I'm not a senior. I am an elder. I am an aging adult. I am an older woman. All of those are fair descriptions of who I am. Please do not segment me as a golden ager. Silver sneakers. I am a jewel. I am valuable. But I am not a rare metal. I have enough. That is a huge fear. I can't tell you how many aging women, particularly women who are not in relationships, who don't have close relationships with family, fear being bag ladies. And sadly, there is a really frightening trend for aging women to be unhoused. We see that challenge in this valley because housing is very, very dear here. We need to start putting some energy into addressing that issue because that's not going to be going away. So I am enough, I have enough. Here's another one, and this is more psychologically based. I believe there is enough. Perhaps some of you have said this at one time, I don't have enough time, don't have enough energy, don't have enough whatever. No. What's that based on? Where does that belief come from? And how can you challenge, not change, but how can you challenge that belief? Because if you do challenge that belief and you find evidence to the contrary, that you do have enough time if you just prioritize things, or you do have enough love in your life if you just open your heart, then miracles happen. And I don't hesitate to say, I used to hesitate to say that, but I've seen it over and over and over again. And last but not least, is what I call the Goldilocks standard. What is good enough? I've had the opportunity to work with several people who have chosen to die. Several of them have taken advantage of the California law that permits that, which, by the way, has just been amended. It got changed. And several people who have just done it on their own. And the law was not involved in, and medical care was not involved in it. Each of these people made a decision to own their life and own their death. I'll share a brief story about how my husband died because it was just the opposite. My husband was a very robust man, and up until the last 3 months of his life, was incredibly active in doing things, engaged in the community. He had, as I have, signed a do not resuscitate order. Unfortunately, he had diabetes, type 2 diabetes, and he had early stages of kidney failure. These are not good things to have when you are getting older. And he had a crisis where he ended up having to go to the hospital. Understandably, we assumed it was going to be a short-term sort of a thing. And when he got into the ER with all of the, you know, the sirens of the, oh my God, they said, you have a do not resuscitate order. Do you want to keep that or not? He said, no, I want to live. I want to live. Understandably. Unfortunately, he caught MRSA in the hospital and went from someone who had a treatable, albeit terminal, you know, chronic condition, to someone who was no longer competent mentally to make decisions about his care. And if he had been competent, he would have returned to the DNR. But instead, they kept him alive in ICU for over 3 months. And I got a call one night from a physician saying, "I'm sorry to tell you that your husband passed away. We spent 45 minutes trying to revive him using CPR, and we could not." That was the last thing my husband wanted. Okay? So I share this with you not to evoke sympathy, but to just let you know that the decisions that we make about what is good enough are important ones to think about. If you haven't done the paperwork, I encourage you to do the paperwork. But more importantly, I encourage you to have the conversations with people who you know and love about how you want to have yourself be treated. What quality of life do you want as you come to the end of it? Because guess what? We're going to come to the end of it, and we're coming to the end of this talk. How about them apples? So, how do we put this all into practice? I've touched on a lot of things today. To all intent and purposes, the best things that we can do to reinforce the foundations of wellness is move, and that's not just your body, it means move your mind and your soul and your body. Eat well, and aren't we lucky to live where we live? You know who I really feel sorry for? Are those folks in the Midwest right now. They have the best harvest ever, and they're only going to have it for like another week because it's so friggin' hot and bad back there. We get to eat it on. Stay cognitively engaged. Okay, and please, do not think that Prevagen and crossword puzzles is going to do it. Okay, save your money. Cognitive engagement is all about challenging old ways of thinking. So, really simple things to do. How many of you are still wearing watches? Okay. Put it on your other hand. And just watch them. Wakes your brain up. Brush your teeth with your non-dominant hand. Your brain will go, "What the?" But it wakes up. And this is my big plug, download a few new apps on your phone. You know, I am really sick and tired of being thought of as technologically ancient. I helped invent some of this stuff, you know? So I'm not apprehensive. I can't say that very well. Apprehensive. Try new things. That'll keep your mind going. And finally, and most importantly, stay connected. If you have relationships that need repair, reach out. We desperately need each other in this world right now. And the chasm and the doubt that has been sown, not just because of the pandemic, but because of the political realities of what we're going through now, we need to repair that. We need to act as elders and offer ourselves up as evidence that we can do things differently, we can survive difficult times, we can be around people who disagree with us and still find a way forward. I'm done. You have been an extraordinary audience. So if you have questions, Dawn is coming up.
Collect your questions. Any questions in this room?
And if you don't, that's okay too, but. We'll collect the questions so that we can read them for the audience.
I want to be responsible for my health, but the practice of medicine keeps interfering. Take off the masks.
Yeah, you know, so here's the thing, right? This is about good practices and feeling safe. And those are two different things. Okay? The challenge here is to be responsible for ourselves and for others. Used to be that that was a small circle. Now, it's much broader. So if you feel comfortable, if you feel responsible enough and you don't think you're communicable, and you are willing, the rest of you, to risk being around somebody like that, take your mask off. I do ask that, because we are following convention here and wanting to, be helpful and supportive as a group norm, that we keep them on, but I understand if you don't want to.
Our next question, what do you know about neuroplasticity?
Oh, neuroplasticity. I can spell it, too. This is one of the most extraordinary things, and I will, that's a whole different lecture, but I'll bring it down to about three different things. Our brains, we don't know squat. And historically, what is so fascinating to me, if you look at the history of modern inventions, as we have discovered a new invention to look inside the body, we come up with a new metaphor to talk about how the brain works. Amy Cao, who will be here, the fourth speaker, she's a neurologist from UCSF. She'll be talking specifically about brain stuff and Alzheimer's, but I'll give you this example. Alzheimer's is named after this German guy, Alzheimer, right? And cutting edge technology in 1900 was this extraordinary microscope. And he took slices of a crazy lady, literally, she was crazy. They all knew she was crazy. Crazy lady's brain fell off. Slices of her brain. And he looked through the microscope, and what he saw were plaques and tangles. And for 122 years, we have been thinking that plaques and tangles are what cause Alzheimer's. But they don't. That was the technology. Nowadays, we have MRNIs, magnetic resonance imaging machines. This gives you 3D color pictures of the brain, which tells us that the brain has dimensions and blood flow. And we're assuming a lot of things from that. When we had electrodes and put them on a person's brain and our hair stood on end, we discovered we had brain waves. And so then we talked about sleep and brain waves. So we have alpha sleep. So I'll get back to the question about neuroplasticity. With all this wonderful new technology, we discovered that synapses, the little things that send all our thoughts through our brain, grow and repair. We don't have to go to the brain store. It takes care of itself. But we don't know why. We don't know how. We do know when certain things go wrong with certain people that certain of these synapses don't work quite as well as they used to. One of the things that I hate to admit is for like 30 years I was talking about how antidepressants like selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors work. I mean, well, I can throw this stuff out at you in my sleep. It's all wrong. Who knew? Well, we're discovering new ways of looking at the brain. Very specifically, what we don't know about the brain is what's going to save us. What we say we do know about the brain reassures us. So neuroplasticity means the brain is constantly growing and changing, adapting. We don't know how, we don't know why, but every day we should thank our stars it does. There'll be a test.
He's kidding.
Thank you. So what she was saying is that the neuroplasticity is about changing ways we do things. It relearns, it reroutes some of our ways that our brain works, and it invigorates. It's like it puts like Miracle Grow on your brain. New things sprout, and some more die off than live. But I mean, you don't want to get into that because that's really sad. It's like, oh God, my brain died. But then, you know, it's awake. Anybody else?
Got more questions?
Yes.
This one is two-part.
Oh.
If you have long-term COVID symptoms yet have not been diagnosed, is there a test to see if you have ever had COVID? Second part, how long do long-term symptoms last?
Okay. I don't know, and I don't know. The first part of that question is, just because you haven't been diagnosed doesn't mean you haven't had COVID. You don't need one to have had it. And my reading, and we can check with some other people along this, but my reading suggests that there is no footprint that COVID leaves. There's not like a genetic footprint that says I've had it, so you know that. We do know by probability, statistical probability suggests. So when you walk outside and it's raining, probability is you're going to get wet. Okay, that's the statistics. With COVID, because it is so much everywhere, the probability is you've been exposed. How your body managed that exposure is the degree to which you experience these symptoms, okay? And that goes to your own specific immune system and immune response, and there are just so many variables that go into that. The second part of the question is what? Memory.
How long do long-term symptoms
last? Yeah. We're 2 years now into studying it, and we probably won't have a definitive answer for that for another 5 to 10 years, just because it's going to take that amount of time to go through the data and know all that. There appear to be three different levels of long-term. For people that have fairly robust immune systems and have had mild symptoms, there is a diminishment between 3 and 6 months after the initial onset of symptoms. So in my case, my long-term COVID symptoms appeared probably 6 months after my diagnosis, and they are still continuing, so I don't fit into that early group. Again, though, because these symptoms could be attributable to other conditions, it's hard to pin the tail on the COVID donkey and say that they're due to that altogether. So I wish I could be more, I feel like Dr. Fauci, you know? Come back next week, I'll give you a different answer, please.
What you were saying about the COVID, because I ended up getting it, I was miserable for 30 days, and I was just like, I've got to go get check what's going on with this, you know? But then after the 30 days, I felt a little better. So
in case you didn't hear that, she was miserable for 30 days after she first got it, but then felt pretty good after that. So no lingering symptoms, no fatigue, no. She, by the way, for those of you that are in the streaming, she's really healthy. Really healthy.
Okay, Dr. Mary, is ignoring the news a good idea?
No. No, it's not a good idea. But monitoring your exposure to the news is a really good idea. Talking to people who have differing opinions that you do is a good idea, as long as you are kind and decent. And exploring other things in addition to the news. But boy, you don't want to be blindsided. You know, sticking your head in the sand is never a good strategy unless you want to get kicked in the ass. And forgive me for being so blunt.
I told you she had a great sense of humor. What disease did your husband catch in the hospital?
MRSA. It's a form of a virus. And do you want to tell me? I'm not remembering what the initials stand for.
Methicillin.
Did you hear that? Methicillin staph-resistant aureus. So it's a really nasty, nasty staph infection. Yeah.
It's very contagious.
Yeah. It is about quarter after by the clock here. Do we have more?
I have one more.
Oh, sorry.
I think it's a recap of your presentation, so I'll give this to you.
Oh, thank you.
And then I'm going to go back to Celia and get the questions from the chat.
Wonderful. Wonderful. While she's doing that, I'll remind everybody that is here that there are opportunities. If you're not a member of Vintage House, I encourage you to consider joining. There are a lot of marvelous programs here. They have a wonderful online series of things that are available. And so in addition to membership possibilities, lovely parting gifts, there's some great food at the back. So we can start doing some getting together here. And if you have a need to leave right now, I want to get some of these questions from our streaming audience, if there are any. But for those of you that may want to head on out and beat the traffic, I understand. Go with God and with health. Yes, no?
I thought you could take an antibody test if you had COVID.
Yes, you can absolutely take an antibody test now, but when I had it, you couldn't. So, the antibody test just tells you if you have the antibody. Doesn't tell you if you had COVID. And I think that was what the question was. Okay? I love being right. You have been a magnificent group of people. Thank you for coming out today.
Please join me in a big round of applause for Dr. Mary Flett. And a couple of follow-ups. I wanted to acknowledge the gentleman in the back from KSBY, Sonoma TV, who are live streaming and recording all four of our presentations. To Celia Cruz de la Rosa from Sonoma Valley Hospital, and Katie from Vintage House. They did a lot of work to put this on. So I hope to see you all back next week, September 14th, 1 to 2:30. Our next guest speaker is Allison Evanson McKinney, and she's going to talk about nutrition, and she's fantastic. I've seen her before here at this venue, so. Thank you for joining us today. Hello there.